The following is a production of the Dallas Genealogical Society. For more information, please visit our website at www.dallasgenealogy.org.
All right, if you will find a table or find a chair with a table or a table with a chair, we will get this meeting started and reward all of the people who are here on time. Well done. Good morning. I'm Tony Hansen. I am the president of the Dallas Genealogical Society, and I welcome you to our March meeting. And if our technology is going to work, I think parking is free today. Was the gate still up when everybody came in? All right, never mind that. Hey, Carolyn, do we have a quorum? Ask Gloria. Nothing like shouting across the room, right? Not that we have any business to transact, but it's good to know.
What's the quorum number?
22, I believe.
22. Yes.
Yes, all right. So if we do have to make any important decisions, we can do it. The previous meeting minutes have been distributed, posted, and everything else, and we'll entertain any corrections, updates, or changes to the meeting minutes if anybody has any. I'll take silences and no. Good. We'll remind you all that we have a Bring a Guest contest going. So if you are a DGS member and you bring somebody who is not a member, and make sure that you tell Gloria when you bring them in and check them in, you'll be entered in a contest, a drawing that we're going to hold in May, where we will draw the name of one lucky person, and you'll win a pass for one of our seminars coming up for the next year. So it's a great organization. Bring a friend, and let them know what a great organization we are, too. Susan Rainwater, are you...
No, that never has been me.
Well, not but the money looks like you. You just scream money.
You better update that picture. And time for me to leave.
I think we need a picture of both me and Linda. Not just me. Okay. Is this thing here? All right. We have, in checking, as of the end of last month, $36,115.82. We have in savings, $121,862.91. Our expenses for February were about $4,100. It's mostly for the upcoming seminar. The income was about $4,600, also mostly the upcoming seminar. We are still looking for volunteers for the board. Tony will have much more to say about that, but specifically for a treasurer. So if you have experience with QuickBooks, or even if you don't and you want to learn, we need you. That's my report.
I spoke to everybody last month about ways that you can support the society by going into either Tom Thumb or Kroger or Amazon Smile and registering the Dallas Genealogical Society as an organization you would like to support. So I just want to remind you of that. It costs you nothing, and if you sign up for it, a percentage of any purchase you make comes to us, which we greatly appreciate. There are instructions on the website, so if you go into membership, down to the business support page, there's a whole page that will tell you step by step what you need to do to sign up for these three organizations, and I would appreciate it if you would do that. Another thing that you can do to support us is to actively engage us in our social media sphere. It's getting more and more important to be out there, so to speak, and engaged in things like Facebook and Twitter and what have you. So this month, my special pitch is to ask you if you would go to Facebook and actively support the Dallas Genealogical Society. So first step, if you don't have a Facebook account, that would be the first thing that you would need to do is get one, and I would encourage you to do that. And then you can support us in one of three ways. You can like our stuff that we post, you can comment on things that we post, or you can repost it. And each one is more and more important and valuable to us as an organization. So as we, and by we I mean Carolyn, who's been our Facebook poster extraordinaire, as we post things on our Facebook page, and if you see them, one way that you can help us is just simply by going to that little like button down there and clicking on it. Now, what that does is it kind of boosts that post out there in the Facebook world. So if you like it, your friends are going to see that you liked it, and maybe they'll look at it, and maybe they'll like it as well. That's how this game works, is we need people to basically work with the things that we have out there and support them. So that's the easiest and simplest thing you can do, is just simply like a post that we put out there. You can turn it up a notch by commenting on our posts. And so you can do this by, down at the bottom of the post, you'll see a little place where you can just start typing something, and you can just say, great event, great speaker, saw him 2 years ago, anything that you care to say. And what that will do is it'll post on your wall with your comment. And again, that raises our visibility in the Facebook world just a little bit higher. More people are going to see it if you actually comment on it rather than just even liking it. If you want to, you can direct your message to somebody that's already in Facebook. So if you start typing the name, like in this case, I started writing Randy, or I typed Randy, and it went to my friends list and said, we've got several people named Randy, and the one I was actually interested in was Randy Whited. And so it will just autofill that in, and it will forward that message to Randy Whited now. So wherever your friend is when you're typing something, if you type their name, it will direct it to them as well. So if you've got neighbors, friends, cousins, whatever, that might be interested in a post we have up there, that's one way to make sure that it shows up on their Facebook wall. And again, by doing that, that raises our prestige in the Facebook world, and it gets more and more visibility to the things that we do. And then finally, the most that you could do that would be most helpful is to share our posts. And so to do that, you can click on the share thing. And again, just it'll give you an opportunity to say something, but it will put it on your wall with your message and, again, give even more credibility to our post. And that's just how Facebook works. The more people that are seeing something, commenting on it, and sharing it, the more it gets seen in the greater sphere of the world. And particularly when that something is something like a seminar or something that we're boosting, you will be helping us advertise it. So these are relatively simple things to do, and I just wanted to go over them with you and show you, you know, how easy it is, and just to encourage you to please support us by supporting us on our social media stuff. It will help us get our message out and attract, you know, more people to our events. And we'll get back to that. And with that, I will bring Kristen up here to talk to us about some of these seminars we have going on.
You got 3 slides, I think.
Oh, I do.
You do.
I just do page down or forward, or okay. Have to learn the technology. Good morning. Well, speaking of Tom Jones, it's 2 weeks from today is our seminar. We currently have 112 people registered. We would love to have more if you're not already registered. We are also having the advanced workshop with him on Friday, which has was limited because it's a has homework even pre-reading, so that's 30 people, and that's all set. So if you're not already enrolled for Saturday, please do. There are ways to volunteer to help us out with that, helping with door prizes, parking tickets, assuming the parking thing is working, helping with lunch. And to do that, you would go to sign up on the web and get under Get Involved. If you do decide to attend, lunch is available for $12, and parking is included, again, if it's working. The remainder of the summer, or the remainder of the year, we have the summer seminar in August 4th and 5th with Lisa Louise Cook, Diane Southard, and Sunny Morton. And then in the fall, we have Josh Taylor. Okay. I can't walk and chew bubble gum at the same time. That's all I've got. Thank you.
I'm glad you spit your gum out first. I want to bring you up to date on some of the things that we've been up to on the board. And what we have been up to is assembling a complete collection of our quarterlies from 1955 through 1994. Now, of course, the library has sets of these, and they're available for you to go view up in the library here. But by having our own set of documents, we can do some more interesting things. And what we have decided to do with these is to do everything we can to get them digitized and permanently enshrined up on the portal to Texas History, which, as you know, is a really great caretaker of all things digital. So in talking to them and getting it cost estimate, it looks like it's going to cost us about $4,500, because there are a lot of them. As you know, it's pretty much our entire early history. But that's going to be the total cost for digitizing them. And so what we have decided to do is to try to make this our project for this year. So starting today, you can donate into this fund that we're going to be collecting to collect enough money to pay for the cost of digitizing them. You can also go on our website now. There is a link on there where you can donate some money that way. We will be applying for grants. There are a variety of grants that are available for us to help offset the cost for that. And then we'll cap this off in next, is it September? That the North Texas Giving Day campaign, we'll use that as kind of our last shot to try to raise the additional funds that we need to raise the amount of money that we need to digitize all these. But it's a great history of our society. Going back and looking through some of those other things, it's just, it's fascinating to read and fascinating to know all that was done. Yes, you have a question or comment? Yes, one of the features of the portal, any document that they digitize is keyword searchable. So you should be able to find things in there that way. One of the documents we also uncovered is actually an index of articles as well, and we will digitize that as part of the process. So again, just if you would like to help us financially, we would love to have your help. Tell your friends. If you see things about this on Facebook, share it, comment, or like it. Hint, hint. Another project that we have been working on and ongoing is indexing our probate records. As you know, we had about 3,100 probate records that were microfilmed. Those were digitized. Those are currently available up on the Portal to Texas History site. We've been going back and filling in some of the information that wasn't indexed. And so this is a project where people take each case, go through all the images, figure out the earliest date and the last date of any of the documents that are referenced there, as well as the date that the person involved died. And we're putting all that back into the metadata to make these documents even more usable, and so people can search on date ranges and find dates of death and stuff. This has been going on for about a year. We are 86% complete. We are nearing the end of this. And so over the past month, our three most erstwhile indexers have been Joe Conley, who did 125 cases, Karen Walker, who did 53, and John Withers, who did 25. So again, there is information on our volunteer sign-up sheet, both for the upcoming seminars, if you want to volunteer for those, and for this. This is easy to do as long as you don't get one of those cases that has 200 images. They do occur, I'm sorry. But there are instructions on there as well, and it's fairly easy just to go through and easy to record the information. So if you've got a little spare time, we would love to have some more help and get this to be 100% done instead of just 86%. Another project that has been underway for a while and it's kind of gotten a bit of a boost is indexing our McGowan Funeral Home records. McGowan Funeral Home was a local funeral home that served the South Dallas community, primarily black constituents. And when that shut down, the Dallas Public Library acquired all of the records from the McGowan Funeral Home. They're up on the 8th floor. And members of our African American Genealogy Interest Group have been indexing these records and recently approached us about trying to speed the process up, so I developed a web interface which now lets many people index these things at the same time. Before that, it was one laptop and there could only be one person keying them. So since about mid-December, we've now had this web interface available and things have been picking up quite a bit there too. So in February alone, we've had quite a bit of activity led by Aura Penn. She did 112 of those cases. Patricia Stigger did 52, Alvin Blakes did 37, and Don Henson, who's the person that I've been working with on the software, he was busy telling me about all the bugs there, which is why he only got one done. But we think we've got the bugs worked out now, and that's progressing quite well. We think there's about 6,000 records, so it looks like we're about halfway done. But the database itself, the nice thing about the new technique is that as they key the stuff in, it's right in our database, which is publicly searchable. So you can search these records pretty much as they key them in. So if you just want to go through, you can go onto our website. It's under our records tab, and you can search through all the records that are already indexed and keep an eye on them as they keep adding more and more records. So it's a great project and going to be a really, really valuable collection. I want to remind you that we're also running a writing contest. We pay cash money for the top three awards for that. So the deadline is March 31st. We will announce the winners in May, but hopefully many of you are boning up and tightening up your articles and getting ready to submit them and having a chance at winning some pretty good cash prizes. And again, our website, if you go look at our Pegasus page, has all the information about what the rules are and how to go about submitting it. But this is primarily how we get our articles, or many of our articles for Pegasus, and we're very proud of the quality of the articles that we do select and that we do end up publishing. Those of you that have a bent for such things, I just want to make you aware that the TSGS conference call for papers is closing on March 18th, the day of our seminar. So if you are a potential speaker and want to get your presentation under consideration. It's a bit earlier than usual this year, so I just want to make you aware of that as well. I think that's 2 weeks from today. Yes, ma'am. It's the Texas State Genealogical Society. They have an annual conference. It's in November, I believe, and this year it's going to be in Houston. October in Houston. It is, yeah, at least I got that right. Okay. Okay, well, it says right there. So anyhow, it is about a three-day event. They bring in, you know, some national speakers and some local speakers on a variety of topics, and typically the focus is on Texas, but it's a you know, a pretty decent conference that you ought to consider going to if you've got any Texas roots. And again, if you would like to have an opportunity at making some presentations to them, they're looking for some good speakers too. Mark Lowe and Mike Lacapo. Oh, you definitely, if you missed Mike Lacapo when we had him here last year, he's worth driving to Houston for, let me tell you. He is a really great speaker, and Mark Lowe is just always entertaining too. Two excellent national speakers. Okay. We have a nominating committee. I want to correct one thing that I said incorrectly. Well, I was heartfelt at the time, but last meeting I said that I was going to be on the committee, and then we got into the board meeting, and I was pointed out that I can't be as president on the committee, so I'm not on the committee. Carolyn Davis gracefully stepped in, and we have several other people who have joined the committee, and I'm going to let Susan talk to us a little bit about this.
Hello. Well, the other three people on the committee it's me, Kathleen, and Bruce Moore. So you have in front of you a handout that is an explanation of the positions that are required by the board. And please take a look at that. We need to announce a slate of officers. Some of them are elected by the members of DGS. Others are appointed. And the handouts will explain. I think there's four positions that are elected: president, vice president, secretary, and treasurer. And as Susan Rainwater pointed out, we are very much looking for a treasurer and think we've got secretary taken care of. We do need, see, we've got secretary, we think. Talk to any of us or go online. If you go to the front page of the DGS website, it does, there's a click there, a link to more information about the nominations. If you want to nominate yourself, please feel free to do that. We really do want people to step up and volunteer. And we need to have all of our nominations in place for the April meeting. So if you've got any questions, please let us know. We also have a handout that explains what the different positions do. And so we have advising positions and we have director positions that are appointed by the president or by the executive committee and the board. And so there is a handout out front if you want more information that gives you detailed description of what these various jobs and positions do. Thank you.
I won't lie to you and say that accepting a board position is necessarily an easy thing to do, but I would tell you it's very rewarding. So I would encourage you to consider it and to give it some serious thought. We have many special interest groups ongoing, and I just want to make you aware of all of them and point out that one of them, the Next Generation Site Builder, has had a date change. Teresa was not able, for a variety of reasons, to meet on March 12th, so we have rescheduled those meetings, which are held on a Sunday, to April 9th. But the special interest groups are a great way to dive a little bit deeper into a variety of topics, again, to meet some other of your fellow genealogists, and just another great way to take advantage of some of the advantages of being a part of a society like ours. So I would encourage you to look these up and to make it a point to visit at least one of them. Our next meeting is April 1st. We'll be back down on the first floor again, and we'll have our own Kelvin Myers speaking to us. He'll be talking about the Texas State Archive, or Texas State Library and Archives, and the General Land Office records that you can get from at home and from visiting the site as well. So Kelvin's a great speaker and a really nice person, and hopefully you'll be here to hear what he's got to say. Hopefully, Todd's got our feedback link up as well, so we would really appreciate hearing from you what you think about this meeting. So if there's anything you can suggest to make it better, make it different or whatever, let us know. We'd be glad to hear from you. But today, we are going to be hearing from Brandon Murray, and he's going to be talking to us about the facilities that were right next door here. So our presentation's, as I said, by Brandon Murray. He's been a librarian at the J. Eric Johnson Library for almost 2 years. He's been integrally involved in the renovation of the Dallas History and Archives Division located here on the seventh floor, which will be the focus of his presentation. Prior to joining the Dallas Public Library, Brandon worked at Southern Methodist University, where he created metadata for digitized photographic collections intended for the Central University. He also posted images and metadata to social media sites, including Tumblr, Flickr, and Reddit. And I imagine he probably played with Facebook, too, right?
Somebody else did, but we had a rotating
thing. And he collaborated with colleagues on creating and modifying catalog metadata guidelines. In addition, he was responsible for proofreading and generating content to promote the Central University Library digital collections. Brandon holds a Master of Library and Information Science degree from the University of North Texas, and I give you Brandon, not Brian, excuse me.
One second, let me get situated here.
All right. Okay. And I will add that he has graciously agreed to allow us to record his presentation, so all of his presentation will be available online for future viewing and any members who are not able to be here today.
Here's your remote, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Some of this might be old hat to you if you've done genealogy for a while. I tried to sort of put this in the context of not only what we have on this floor, but what the library has in general in relation to genealogical resources, and also the Vital Statistics Office is a recent addition to the building, and so how that might be useful to you as well. And I also want to thank my colleague, Sammy Lee, who is a longtime staff member in this department, has a lot of genealogical experience, and she was integral in helping me put this together. A lot of the materials we had were not available for use when I was first hired, because we were in the middle of a renovation process. So we were in a temporary space in the first floor of this building, and a lot of things were on pallets in various parts of the building and inaccessible. So it's really only been since August of this year that I've really been able to delve in and use the full scope of where our collection is. So she was really integral in helping me point some things out that I might not have been aware of previously. So with that, let me get started. We have a collection of materials in our division that's one of the largest of its kind in the nation. Our holdings span many aspects of the diverse history of not only Texas, but the surrounding area and the Metroplex as well. We collect, preserve, and make available information in text, graphic, audio, and video formats. Because many of the unique items are fragile, the resources we have here don't circulate outside of the library, so unlike any of the other floors, if you come here, you can't check anything out, but that's what we have, our lovely reading room, so you can come in and sit down and use our resources there, and we will retrieve them for you from our limited access areas. And I'll go into more of what our renovation entailed in a second. We also have a fine books division, which is separate from the regular archive. It's a it was founded by the through the help of the Friends of the Public Library many decades ago, and basically it's a collection of rare and unique books that cover not only the history of printing but also of the history of civilization and ideas as well. And none of those funds are used with tax money. It's all donations from private individuals and organizations, and so we have a lot of really unique materials that we're very proud to highlight, and part of the renovation allowed us to really delve into that more and make more of that available to the public for viewing. Let's see. We closed in March of 2015 to begin a renovation process. From April of 2015 to March of 2016, we were operated out of a temporary space on the first floor of the Central Library. As I said, most of our materials were packed away. We had a limited amount of things that were available. Our reference books were still available at the time, and our photograph collections were available. But all of our manuscripts were packed away, and all of our fine books were not available at the time. It was over 250 pallets of materials, tens of thousands of reference books, which we then had to move back to the seventh floor in time for our opening on August 20th. The total renovation project cost was nearly $6 million. That was a combination of city money and also money that was raised by the Friends of the Dallas Public Library. So what a lot of the new features that we have are was a redesigning and reorganization of the 40,000 square foot floor, increased public usage spaces and meeting spaces. They updated the mechanical, electrical, and the plumbing. We have a new fire suppression system, and electrical and lighting systems. The really great thing about our fire suppression system is that unlike traditional emergency sprinklers, which are basically pipes that have water just sort of standing in them until it's time for a fire, our system is, or if you want to put it that way, I guess, our system is set up to where the water, there's no water in a pipe at all. It's all in a central location, and so if there were a fire, then the area that was being experiencing the emergency would have water routed to it. So therefore, you would avoid any kind of water leakage over time from pipes leaking and things like that, which are can be very dangerous in an archive situation as far as preserving materials. You don't want them to get water damaged and have mold and that kind of thing. So we have a really great system in place that will prevent that from happening. We have increased archival storage facilities, including a lot more high-density shelving, which allows us to pack away a lot more material. Before the renovation, we had trouble fitting new books on the shelves in our reference area, and now we have room to expand for decades, which is really great. We have new high-density microfilm cabinets and dedicated shelving for our ledger books. The ledger books are something that's really neat. They are large, sort of oversized ledgers that have permits, permit records from the early part of the 20th century, and they're very large and fragile, and so we now have a dedicated space that we can put them in, kind of keep them safe. We have more space for a map collection area, as well as more floor space for card catalogs, cabinets, and processing areas. While we are trying to go in a more digital route, we do actually have still physical card catalogs that are very useful for researchers, not only in our public area, but also in the back, too. So even though we are in a digital age, we do have actual old card catalogs that still exist in our collection. Also, we have a dedicated photo room. And actually, I'm on the photo team here, so that's a lot of where I spend my time. Has increased shelving, a dedicated room for negative storage, and new computers and scanning equipment. So we have a portion of our images that are available on the online catalog. We are hoping to get a lot more of that put online. Right now, it's just a fraction of what we have in total, but that's something we want to really improve upon, and that having these new spaces will allow us to do that with a lot more ease. We have built-in and mobile display cases to exhibit unique collections. The Kenneth Johnson Gallery, which is out there in the hall, and after this presentation, I will give you a brief tour of our public space and kind of explain the layout of things and what everything is and what we have available. That has actually allowed us to exhibit more of our rare books and artifacts, as well as our artwork that we have. We have the Margaret McDermott Study Room, which is attached to the reading room. It's for small class instruction and quiet study. It's very useful for doing research and just kind of having a quiet place to do work with materials. We have the interactive wall, also known as the Digital Interactive Gallery, which is that giant multi-screen display that you see out there. It's for multi-person viewing of our digital collection items. So, and I was in on the team that helped design that. And what basically it's an opportunity for us to highlight different resources we have by making digital exhibits and interactive experiences that you can go and look at, and gives you an idea of the various things that we have in our collection. And I can go over that more in detail on the tour. Our new seventh floor reading room, that's an image of it. You can see that those wooden tables actually are from the 1901 Carnegie Library, so they are actually from the original Dallas Public Library. And they were restored, and we have them here. You can see that's a microfilm cabinet right there that has a portion of our microfilm. Some of the microfilm we have is available in the reading room. A large portion of it, though, is in the back, and we would have to retrieve it for you, but that's not a problem at all. And we also have, you can't really see it from here, but no longer do we have those old clunky microfilm readers that you might be accustomed to using. We have state-of-the-art, brand-new digital microfilm readers that are actual computers that allow you to do really neat stuff with them, including zooming in, cropping. You can do like brightness and contrast. So if you ever look at a particularly difficult microfilm reel that's hard to read, you can do a number of things on the computer to make it more legible, and then before you can print it out, or you can actually even save it to a flash drive or email it to yourself. So it's a lot more user-friendly and kind of makes having to deal with a really sort of difficult microfilm a lot easier to use. That's an image of the Digital Interactive Gallery. As you can see, that's one of the exhibits that we have there. That's actually from our opening back in August. In our catalog materials, we have over 65,000 books on all aspects of Texas, city directories, school annuals, entire collection related to the JFK assassination, church histories, architecture, educational books, and biographies related to people from Texas. Our photographs collection has over 1 million images in it. Over 6,000 images are in our online catalog. We ideally want to get that number a lot higher, and that's something we're working towards. That includes photographic prints, glass negatives, plastic negatives, slides, and we also have a 10,000 visual file image card system in our reading room, which is basically several drawers of a cabinet that has cards with images on them and metadata. So it's an analog way of sort of looking through a portion of what we have, and that was a legacy from before they did a lot of the online digital stuff. But it's still very useful for finding quick, you know, photographs, because they're done by category, so you can find things based on like parks and things like that, depending on what you're looking for. Just a quick little easy reference. And I'm also going to mention too, we are always looking for new items to expand our collection. So if you have materials that you might want to donate, if you're cleaning out your garage or a storage unit, or you know, just have things that you know you might want to get rid of, think of us. Photographs that you have from, you know, family photographs from, you know, decades ago or even to today, we'd be happy to take, because even though an image might, you know, a current image might just be something that you think is just not historical today, you know, an image taken yesterday might be considered an historical image 50 years from now. So we're always looking to take more photographs and anything else. So if you, you know, always think of us when you might want to donate something, and we're happy to look at it and see if it's something we can add and then work with you to retrieve it and add it to our collection. We have vertical files, which are deal with DFW businesses, clubs and organizations, people, churches, crimes, and a lot of other things. They cover dates from the mid-1950s forward with some earlier things. Largely it's from Dallas Morning News articles, Dallas Times Herald articles, and other miscellaneous items, including like flyers. I know we have some like political brochure things, depending on the subject matter. And so a lot of different ephemera and things like that on any number of subjects. We have both based on subject area and also on, we have biofiles. The subject matter ones are listed on our departmental website by subject. And the biofiles are not currently on the website, but we can always look that up for you if you think you might want to see if someone has a file of clippings that's easy for us to check. We also, you know, are always looking for things to add to our vertical clipping file. So if you have old articles or things or anything you think that might be useful, we'd be happy to take a look at those as well and see if those might be something that we can add to a vertical file. We have over 1,500 serials, including newspapers, both current and historical, from many Texas cities and towns, and including magazines as well. Our map collection has over 7,000 maps. Maps related to Texas and Mexico are from 1800 to the present, and then Dallas was about 1846 to the present. These include land ownership, streets and highways, trails and railroad maps. We have Murphy and Bland's maps, and Sanborn fire and fire insurance maps, which are actually, the Sanborns are available also on the library website in the databases section as well. And they're very useful for doing property research and trying to figure out, you know, who lived in a particular home and what that home looked like as far as when it was first built, if there was like an attached garage or a storage shed that was originally part of the property, that will tell you what was originally there. And that's very useful if you're trying to restore things. Yes?
What is the Murphy and Bland's?
The Murphy and Bland's is another set of maps that I believe cover the earlier part of the 20th century, and they have, I think it's, they tell you who lived on certain addresses. They actually have the name of the person. I haven't used them that much, but we do have them available, I believe, on microfilm, and also on a separate website that we have. It's like a website within our website. I haven't used them much, but I've known people that have found very useful things in researching. So we have many different ways to sort of solve the same problem. So if you can't find information one way, we can always try to see if there's another resource that we have that can come up with the same answer. Our manuscript collections have over 500 different manuscript collections within the manuscripts umbrella of our archive. This is over 4,500 linear feet of material, which includes pioneer families' information, architectural materials, ethnic communities in Dallas, women's history, council members and mayors, and business history. So any number of different things you can think of, we would have something in a manuscript collection that might deal with it and might be useful in genealogical research. Our fine books division, as I mentioned, it does not use tax revenue to acquire books. It's all based on donations. We have over 2,750 volumes that have been donated or gifted to us by Dallas citizens. And our main areas, as I sort of mentioned before, are the history of printing in the book, the history of ideas, particularly those that have exerted major influence on Western civilization, and fine printing, the art of the book. One thing that I think is really neat, too, is we have little miniature books, which are, miniature book binding is its own separate thing that's really neat, and so we have some of those as well. We have a page or a leaf from a Gutenberg Bible, a papyrus fragment from the Egyptian Book of the Dead, all kinds of things that are really neat, and we're happy to share with the public, and that's part of what the Johnson Gallery is allowing us to do. We have what's known as the lost copy of the Declaration of Independence. It's the only copy of the Declaration of Independence west of the Mississippi River. Essentially, when they printed the Declaration back in 1776, they printed multiple copies so they could disseminate it throughout the colonies, and ours was printed actually earlier on the printing run than the one that signed in Washington, D.C., and it was discovered in the 1960s in a bookstore in Philadelphia. The bookstore was closing down, and they were cleaning it out, and in their basement, they found a perfectly pristine copy of the Declaration. And so it was put on auction, and a group of Dallas citizens bid on it and then donated it to the city. It was originally at City Hall, and then eventually it was moved over here, I believe, shortly after this building was built in the 80s. And so it's referred to as the lost copy, since it was found in that bookstore so long ago. But I happen to really like our copy, because I think it's very pristine. It doesn't have all the signatures of it, that they do in D.C., but I think it's a really perfect example of, the way it looks, and it's in a lot better condition than the one in D.C., in my opinion. I often think of this as like America's first tweet, So, and that's just a few feet away from us. And I'll addition of what we have on this floor, and the Declaration exhibit and the Shakespeare's First Folio exhibit are untouched from the renovation. They are as they were prior to the renovation. The Shakespeare's First Folio that we have was printed in 1623, and it was the first concerted effort to actually collect and publish Shakespeare's works. What was happening at the time is that he had passed away, and so there were versions of his plays that were being disseminated that were inaccurate or corrupted based on, people were putting up works that they said were his work that wasn't accurate, or it was just not one of his plays at all. And so a group of people that he worked with at the Globe Theater kind of got together and compiled all of the things that they had remembered or had from when they worked, in his productions, and then actually had it printed. And we've got one of the few existing copies that are left, and it's on display over there. We also have Scene on the Brazos by Frank Ray from 1893. He was a very prolific Texas artist who was very influential on a lot of, Southwestern art, and a lot of artistic movements in the earlier part of the 20th century in Texas. He donated this to the Dallas Public Library when it was opened in 1901, when the original Carnegie Library was opened. And originally, that library had an art room with a lot of different paintings, but then that actually became the basis for the Dallas Museum of Art. That was moved over to the DMA when that was founded. But Frank Ray was very insistent that he donated this to the library. He wanted to stay here. So it's actually been here in the library system since then, and it's actually hanging on the wall out there in the hall. And this is our website. I plan to provide a PDF version of this PowerPoint to you as well, which I will email and you can disseminate it. But this is our web address for our departmental website, which you can also access through the main library website as well. So while the 8th floor of the genealogy department of this library has been previously rated by a leading family history magazine as one of the top 10 genealogy collections in the United States, those researching families with histories with strong Dallas or Texas collections connections can benefit from the holdings that we have on our floor. And the Dallas Public Library system as a whole has a number of useful resources that, you know, will help you as well. And you probably already know this, but in an effort to give you greater context, I'm sort of going to kind of walk through basic genealogical research and how our resources kind of fit into that. So to successfully document an ancestor, you really need to know their name, the approximate date of birth or death, and the location where the ancestor resided. And to find that information, you often use census records and census substitutes, tax records, vital records, cemetery records, obituaries, and marriage records. The census and census substitutes, as you might know, you can identify an ancestor's residence every 10 years from the 1790 census all the way to 1940. The census records are closed from the public for a period of 72 years. All the census records for Texas and the U.S. are available on Ancestry. One exception is the 1890 census because there was a fire in the early 20th century. I forget which governmental building it was, but it destroyed a large portion of the records from that census. And then in the 1880 census is when they started listing family members as well. The 8th floor has census on microfilm from 1790 to 1930. So pretty much everything you could find on Ancestry minus the 1940 census. The 8th floor also has a Soundex system, which is a coding system for the census used to group people, their names together based on how they sounded. It's useful for names with different spellings. And I have an example here from the National Archives website, and it's sort of using a numeric code to kind of group like-sounding names together. And so they have a version of that on the 8th floor that you can use as well, which is useful. Tax records are generally a yearly listing of residents and of the residents and status, and it comes into play once your locality is established. It's helpful in determining when a person arrives and departs in an area, either by relocating or death. And if it's by death, it also may reflect in the following year what the name of the widow is, and so that can kind of be helpful as well. Tax records on microfilm are currently housed on the 8th floor of the library. At one point, they were down here, but now they are on 8. City directories are a big thing that we have here on the 7th floor. They can help identify your an ancestor's residence every year. The 7th floor maintains a collection of telephone and city directories and crisscross directories for cities not only in Dallas, but also across Texas, both in hard copy and microfilm. We don't have every city every year, but we do have a large number of cities and a large number of years, so we can help. And so chances are we will have something that will help you find, you know, somebody or at least get close enough that you can kind of, you know, be assisted by it. It lists the ancestor's residence and occupation. In many cases, the name of the wife is included. One thing to note when you're using the city directories is that it took a year for them to compile the information. So if you're looking at like the 1950 directory, the information you're looking at is actually from 1949. So it's the previous year's information. So, that's something to keep in mind when you're actually looking at them. We have a list of what directories and phone books and things that we have as part of our website as well. Older city directories have three types of listings, name by street, and after 1901 they were arranged alphabetically by street name and then by number, and also types of businesses or occupation, i.e. whether it was they were grocers, attorneys, etc. City directories, one thing to note for Dallas is they were renumbered twice, the streets were, both in 1891 to 92 and 1911, and the 1911 directory gives both the old and the new street numbers, so it's useful to try to figure out where that switch was and how that might have affected the person that you're trying to track. If the building you're researching predates 1901, find the 1901 directory street listing and note the name of the occupant And then you can use the older ones to search by name. And also, what's important to do when you're using a SETI directory is to refer to the beginning of the directory, because there's often the list of helpful abbreviations and symbols and demographic information that can help you sort of decode what you're looking at. And I've also been told that some early directories may even indicate death dates. So this is an example from a 1952 directory that has a list of abbreviations, got telephone exchanges, which is useful to kind of figure out what you're looking at. This is from a Worley's directory. There was Kohl's, there was Worley's, there was a couple, you know, there was more than one directory company that made them. And so depending on what directory it was, it might list them slightly differently. But our staff here can help you decipher them. And so this is also another list of general abbreviations. It's hard to see here, but it's just not only directional things, but based on occupation and then abbreviation of given names and things like that. So that, you know, so those are useful for trying to decode what you're looking at. And then also, this is from a 1998 Kohl directory. Has a lot of symbols, and it tells you what the symbols mean, whether they're whether it's a house number or a room number, whether it's a business listing, whether it's a duplicate business, whether it also tells you if that was the first year that that person showed up in that particular address. So this is useful to kind of also figure out what you're looking at too. And also, same thing with this. It has some different numerical coding and things like that. So for vital records, birth and death records in Texas are a more modern record. Vital records were not required prior to 1903, except for a very brief time in the 1870s. Many birth and death records from 1903 up to the late 1930s were never recorded. The advent of the Social Security Administration is really what got things going as far as like keeping consistent birth records. Some births during that time were later recorded as part of that as probated or delayed births, and a lot of that is available on Ancestry. And death certificates are a good primary source, but they also contain secondary information, so that's something to consider because sometimes the cause of death or whatever might not be accurate. So, like if you're aware of something from a family history, it may not be the same as what a death certificate says for whatever reason, so it's good to be able to make note of such discrepancies when you find them. We have indexes to birth and death records on microfilm. Birth records indexes between 1903 and 1997, and birth certificate indexes from 1903 to 1932. Birth records are closed for a period of 75 years, but we also have death record indexes from 1903 to 2000, and the death certificate indexes from 1903 to 1982. Looks like death certificates are closed for a period of 25 years. A lot of these records are available on Ancestry or FamilySearch as well, but we do have microfilm copies of them. As I mentioned before, the Bureau of Vital Statistics is now a new addition to the family of this building, and we're glad to have them. And they can be useful, but there are some caveats that you have to be aware of when you're using them as opposed to trying to get information on Ancestry. They have a fee-based same-day service, so they do give birth certificates, death certificates, birth abstracts, acknowledgments of paternity, and a funeral home service and notary service. However, they involve fees and requests must be in writing and with proper photo ID. Death records are available for deaths that occur within the city of Dallas from April 1983 to the present. Confidential records may only be released to qualified applicants, which is the person named on the record, a member of the immediate family, and all other applicants must provide a notarized letter authorizing them by an immediate family member to be able to access that. And they also have to photo ID. So there's some more hoops you have to jump through in order to be able to access that. The other factors of use is that legal representatives or legal guardians must provide legal documentation such as contracts or court orders that demonstrate a direct tangible interest in the birth certificate. Birth records are available for births that occurred anywhere in the state of Texas for the years of 1926 to the present. The default for requesting birth certificates is a certified copy of the birth facts or the short form. The long form birth certificate, which includes the parents' a date of death, must be specifically requested and they can only provide long-form birth certificates for births that occurred within the city of Dallas from April 1983 to the present. So they can't do long-form for further back than that. Cemetery records, burial records often provide birth and death dates. Mortuary records are also helpful. The Ed C. Smith Funeral Home records are located on the eighth floor and are quite useful. A number of Dallas cemeteries have been published. Shirley Remnant Sloat's book, Dallas County Records of Interest in the Genealogist at the J.R. Johnson Central Library is very useful, and we have a copy available in our seventh floor reference desk. Oakland Cemetery, one of the largest and earliest cemeteries in Dallas, is online through Dallas Genealogy, and there's microfilm also in the genealogy section on the eighth floor. There's published abstracts for other Texas counties on both our floor and the eighth floor, and then you can also find cemetery resources from Find a Grave and buildinggraves.com. Modern obituaries are great. Obituaries are a great resource as well. Modern obituaries are a great source for obtaining information about the deceased. The further back you go, however, the information become less helpful. Newspapers are a vital source for birth and death information contained in obituaries. Dallas and other Texas newspapers are maintained on microfilm. We have a complete list of what we have in our holdings on our website. And one thing to note is that while the Dallas Morning News is also available on a database through the library, the Dallas Times Herald, which we have, is only available on microfilm. So while it's a great resource, it's not digitized, so you'd have to come in and look at that manually. One thing you can do in general when using the Dallas Times Herald is if you can always check the Morning News database to see if you can find some kind of reference there that might narrow down the date, and then use that to be able to pull a specific reel from the Times Herald. But you know, since the Morning News owns the Times Herald material, they have not made an effort to make that available online at all. So that's but it is available. You just have to be able to sort of know what you're looking for, and then pull the right reel and do it that way. And then our vertical clipping files can be useful for obituaries and marriage information. A lot of marriage announcements get published in the paper, and so that might be something that's in our biographical clipping files, depending. So that can be helpful as well. Newspapers are really good for notices of deeds of transfer, probate matters, civil and criminal court proceedings, marriages, births, anniversaries. And the Dallas newspapers pick up information from all over the state, so there could be something from a different city that's also published in the Dallas papers as well. And also, a recent thing that's been happening is that funeral homes have started publishing obituaries and items related to people, you know, on their website. So while, you know, it could be that the individual's family didn't take an obit out in the paper, but they did publish something on the funeral home's website. So that could be another avenue of research as well. As I mentioned before, the Dallas Morning News is available as a database from Newsbank, and that's available from the library. There's basically two different Dallas Morning News databases within that system. There's the Historical Morning News, which covers October 1st, 1885 to December 31st, 1984, and that actually shows you in the database what the actual article looked like in the paper. And it's searchable, and you can pull up specific articles and print them and email them to yourself. It also has, it's the same for the Star-Telegram from 1902 to 1991, and the Fort Worth Morning Register from 1897 to 1902. So those you can actually go online, and if you have a library card, you can do it from home. Otherwise, you're welcome to come into this building or any other Dallas Public Library branch and get on the computer, and you can actually pull up specific Morning News articles. But then the second database that's available is basically 1985 to the present. Thereabouts. I think the Morning News is having an issue with Newsbank, so I think they stopped putting stuff on Newsbank as of a few months ago. So it's not like the most current, but what it does is that will allow you to see what the article says, but it's just the electronic text, so it doesn't actually show you the article, it just shows you the text of what it said. So it's good for informational purposes, but it doesn't actually give you an actual copy of what it looked like in the paper. So it's something to consider. But the good news is that we have the Dallas Morning News on microfilm up until 2014. So you can actually use the database to find the right date and article that you want, and then use our microfilm to actually print out a copy of what it looked like. For marriage records, the best source for learning the female's maiden name is often in marriage records. The Dallas County's Index to Dallas Marriages, 1846 to 1963, is located on the 8th floor. The date in this index reflects the date of the license, not the date of the marriage. Marriage records are only actual marriage records themselves are only available at the Dallas County Clerk's Office, which I believe has been moved recently to the 21st floor of the Renaissance Tower, 1201 Elm Street. I think the Clerk's Office is actually using the 21st and the 22nd floors, but I think the marriage records specifically are held on the 21st, from what I've been told. And then marriage records indexes for most Texas counties are available on microfilm on the 8th floor, as well as published abstracts for Dallas County that have been published by the Dallas Genealogical Society. Marriage records were long kept by individual counties, but they were not a requirement that the state would. The state didn't keep their own copy of the records as a rule until 1967. So before then, it was really the purview of the individual counties. So that's something to consider as well. After the names have been identified, a location established, and birth and death dates obtained, you know, what's next? What do you need to do, and what can our resources help you do? Well, part of it is building a more complete picture of the person. You can do that through land records, probate records, court records, maps, published histories, military records, church records, yearbooks, serials and magazines, and manuscript collection items. So one thing to keep in mind is that when you're searching for sort of collateral associations between individuals, that a family leaves more records than an individual. So if you try to really do research based on a family level, you might find more things than if you're really trying to focus on one specific person. Land records, we have land grants. The Texas Land Survey maps for Dallas County and Sam Street maps are available in the library catalog. Their published land survey maps are available for other Texas counties as well. So that's something you can actually search in our library catalog and find a record for and look at it as well. The indexes for deeds or early deeds are available on the 8th floor. Probate records, will and estate case papers, 1846 to 1900, are available both on our floor and the 8th floor. After 1900, the indexes are at the county clerk's office. The records are located off-site. I don't know if that's still the case or not, but that... Also, during slavery, slaves were sometimes included as property, so that might give you a person's name that way. So that's something to consider. Court records, all the following records are currently located on our floor, the 7th floor, which is district court records, divorces and civil cases are on microfilm, naturalizations, published indexes, case papers, 1872 to 1912, declarations of intention, 1889 to 1903, are on microfilm. Inquest records, microfilm for each district in Dallas, are also on the 7th floor, and they may have death certificate from a justice of the peace or a coroner as well, depending on the record. I hit the wrong button. Sorry.
I told you not to do that.
Well, my thumb slipped, sorry.
Hopefully we can get it back here.
Yeah, there we go.
Yay.
All right, I'll watch my thumb more this time. We also have a lot of maps. Our map collection is pretty diverse and as far as Texas and Dallas. And we have a database on our website that can help you. It can give you the description of what the map is and also the case and folder number or drawer number so that we can actually go pull it for you to look at in our reading room. Murphy and Bland's maps are also available on our website through a separate interface. And the Sanborn Fire Insurance maps are available both on microfilm and also on the database in the library, and those are useful. Like I said, for finding out, you know, who lived on certain streets and what the property looked like as well. Bracey's block maps are available in microfilm, but they only exist for specific years, 1937, 42, 49, 54, and 58, and that identifies who lived in a house. That's useful. And that's just an example of what our maps database looks like on our website. So if you were to search, put the word Dallas in there, it would pull up a list of different maps, and you'd click on the link, and it would tell you the drawer, you know, the case and drawer number, and it would be something that we could then go and retrieve for you. One thing to note also is that if you ever needed it, we have the ability to get a map reproduction done. Basically, what it is we send it out to a vendor, and they can give you a digital scan of the map that you can use for whatever you need it to. We don't print them ourselves, but we at least give you the map scan. And what we do actually provide in-house is a photographic reproduction service. So if you ever needed to find photographs of any kind, whether it's buildings or people, and that you find something in our collection that you want to use, for whatever reason, we would actually be able to give you a high-resolution digital scan for your use. Like, say, if you wanted, were writing a book and you wanted to publish one of our images, we could do that for you. And there is a fee-based structure that starts at $25 per image. And then depending on when your intended use, there might be additional fees. But it basically starts at $25 per image. And then you get a high-resolution digital scan and then also permission to use it for whatever project you're using it. And so that can be really useful as well. We also have people that just want to find images they think are neat, and they get a high-resolution scan, and they print it out and, you know, have it hanging in their home or whatever. So we can do it in any number of different things. We have a lot of published histories. Mug books, which are sort of histories about Dallas that have, like, biographical features in them. Family histories and bios. Historical overviews about Dallas, and they're also the same for other Texas counties within our collection. So sort of general overview reference books that you can use to kind of get started on that. Military records, the best source for military records in Texas are located on the 8th floor. They have the National Archive, the NARA records from the American Revolution to the Philippine Insurrection, and they're starting to get World War I materials as well, I believe. There's also the full 3 database available through the Dallas Public Library website, which contains military records, including the stories, photos, and personal documents of the men and women who served. So that's useful for finding things. I think I found my grandfather's the request for a military headstone that was submitted by my great-grandmother or something like that, when I just happened to just do a quick search to get familiar with the database. So you never know what you'll find, and it's kind of interesting, because it actually also gave his military ID number, which I never knew. So you never know what you can find in these things. Church records are great for establishing an ancestor's religion. You also sort of need to know. It's helpful to know sort of their denomination, so you can sort of know where to look a little bit. Not all church records are equal. If the ancestor is Catholic, there's a lot more vital information contained and registers belonging to the diocese. Whereas if the ancestor was perhaps Baptist, with the exception of church histories and records of membership, there'd be very little other information. So it sort of depends upon the denomination as to the level of record keeping that was done. But that is one avenue of research as well. We have a great yearbook collection. It's all done based on donations. So I'm very proud of the level of completeness we have, considering it's completely done by donation. But we have a large number of Dallas area high schools. We from various years. We don't have every year, and we don't have every school, but we do have quite a number of them. And we've even got some junior highs, I believe, as well. And that's something, while I'm talking about it, that's something that I think I want to go ahead and mention, is we're always looking for more yearbooks. So if you're cleaning out your attic or your garage and you find old yearbooks and you're not wanting to keep them, let us know, and we will be happy to add them to our collection, because we're always looking to fill gaps. And you can look at our website, too. There's a section for yearbooks and annuals, and it will tell you exactly what yearbooks we have and what schools. It's done by city, so you have to, it's alphabetically by city. So for Dallas, you'd have to go to find Dallas and then scroll down and see what we have. But that can give you an idea if we already have a yearbook or not. If we don't, please come, you know, donate it to us. We'd be happy to add it to our collection. The other thing, too, is that serials and magazines that we might have in our collection may have articles about the locality where an ancestor lived and events that may have influenced their lives. So we could have a magazine or a newspaper, you know, a periodical article in our collection that might be directly related to something that you're researching genealogically. Manuscript collections may contain letters, diaries, or other papers or ephemera that might be useful, and they may have information about your ancestor or people who touched their lives in places where they resided as well. Certain genealogical collections exist within our manuscript collections, so there are certain manuscript collections that we have that were very genealogically oriented, you know, as far as their focus. So that's actually really useful for research. And depending upon what the manuscript collection was that was donated, it could be anything from like employment records to, you know, personal diaries. I remember seeing something that was recently donated right after I got here. It was somebody's work papers, and it had not only information on the individual who was the focus of the collection, but it had a large number of things related to his personal assistant and memos that were sent about like training that she went on and like awards she received. And so even though the manuscript collection was focused on her employer, there were a number of things for that individual that if you're researching might be useful to help you narrow down, you know, where she lived and what she did and things like that. And so it could be really useful for you. Additional online resources that we have the Marion Butts collection, which he was a very prolific African-American photographer, and we have his photographs. And we have actually a website that's linked to ours. It's a separate site that actually has a number of his images on them as well, that has photo galleries. We have oral histories, both in audio cassette and transcript form, so a large number. Depending on who you are researching or what the topic is, you might find an oral history that deals with some information regarding that. We have maps and other digitized content, various databases, including the Morning News. We have America's Genealogy Bank. Let's see. Okay. So America's Genealogy Bank is another database that we have to conduct genealogical searches with over 300 years of historical newspapers, books, pamphlets, and government reports. That's an example of the Sanborn fire insurance map that I was talking about. As you can see, it gives you the street. It tells you that's the county court, county courthouse. So that gives you sort of the layout of that. It tells you that it was being built at the time that this was made in 1892. So it gives you sort of a status of the structures as well, whether they were completed, whether they were under construction, things like that. So there's also a number of other databases that may or may not be useful for you, depending on what you're researching. The New England Historical and Genealogical Society has a database on our through us that's very useful. America's Obituaries and Death Notices is the largest and most comprehensive collection of newspaper obituaries and death notices, and that also has Dallas Morning News obituaries from 1984 to September of 2014. There's a bibliography of Native North Americans, a bibliographic database covering all aspects of Native North American culture, history, and life. So if you're doing Native American research in your genealogical searches, that might be useful for you as well. There's also an American Indian Histories and Cultures database with manuscripts, artwork, and rare printed books dating from the earliest contact with European settlers right up to photographs and newspapers from the mid-20th century. So that could also be applicable to what you're looking for, as well as the American West database, which has a large number of different materials, including manuscript items, trade cards, wanted posters, photographs, etc., that are sort of like, you know, frontier and Old West related kind of emphasis. The Handbook of Texas is another thing that's available through our databases, and that's useful for just general research on not only people, but entities within Texas, whether it's famous businesses or even towns and things like that. They've got pretty much an entry for everything you can think of. So that's a good sort of starting point to kind of get your, you know, ideas, your juices flowing as far as like where you want to focus and see what you can get general information on a topic that, or a person that you can then branch off and say, okay, well, they were once like a mayor of this city or something in Texas. Well, in that case, then I can go and find this or that, you know, depending on what it says that's notable about their background. There's a Who's Who database that has 1.3 million biographies of notable men, women, in all fields of endeavor from around the world. Heritage Quest has a lot of useful records, including census records. And then Residence USA is not really one that's very... their historical element to that website, I think, only goes back to like 2004. But basically what Reference USA does is that allows you to like look up business and residential records for individuals to get phone numbers and addresses of more recent information for people. And that's really useful just in general, not only for genealogical research, but like for trying to find any number of different phone numbers and addresses of businesses or people. You'd be surprised what you can find on there. When they did a training, one of the reps for this actually decided he wanted to, as an example, pull up every Whataburger that existed in the United States, and it pulled up exactly. It could tell you not only where they were located, but whether they are verified. So it was like ones that went out of business and when they went out of business, you know, that kind of thing. So it can help you track a number of different things in a more recent way, depending on where you're starting in your genealogical research. So that's our contact information. This email address is our general departmental email. So you can email us with questions related to, you know, obituary searches, or if you want to look at historic photographs or just have any kind of, you know, research questions in general, just email that email address and one of our staff members will happily get back with you. Usually takes about a day or two before we can respond, just based on volume of emails and whatnot, but we're always happy to answer your reference questions, and you can always give us a call too, and someone on the reference desk will be more than happy to answer any questions you have. So I hope this was useful, you know, and kind of telling you what we have that might help you in your genealogical research in the future. But if you have any questions, let me know. Go ahead. No, they're actually connected with the city secretary's office. It's actually under, if you go to the city secretary's website, actually, I think that's how you get their contact information. And they're the official municipal archives of Dallas. So they have a lot more like governmental information related to former city employees and other researchers, other materials as well. I think John Slate is their archivist. And so they have a number of things that we kind of have complementary things that they do, but they also have things that we don't. So they're another good resource as well. I think with them, though, you have to make an appointment. So, but that's something that can be done, you know, ahead of time. But they do have a number of really good resources as well. Go ahead.
You changed your name from the Texas Dallas Collection to the Dallas History and Archives.
Mm-hmm.
Changing the focus?
Well, I think... I think what it was it all had to do with sort of the timing and the renovation. It was sort of like a new floor, a new way to showcase what we have. And I think the name change was a way to sort of re-emphasize what our focus already was. We do focus on Texas at large, but our primary focus is Dallas. That's our first area of interest. So we focus on Dallas first and then go outward depending on what, you know, resources people have to donate and that kind of thing. So we're always happy to take anything Texas related. It doesn't have to be just Dallas. It could be anything from the state of Texas, you know, at large as well. But I think we first and foremost, we start with Dallas, since that's where we are and that's where a lot of people have a lot of their research. It was like local stuff. So go ahead.
I noticed in a couple of places you mentioned the Morning News
Mm-hmm. Well, the Morning News had some kind of contract dispute with Newsbank, not only Newsbank, the database, but also whatever company they were doing microfilm production with. So they stopped actually submitting stuff to get filmed. So we have not been able to get microfilm since then. I don't think it's ever been resolved, to my knowledge. Yes? I don't even know if they're microfilming it. I don't know if it's that they're microfilming it, but we're just not getting it, or if they've just. I think what's happening, to my knowledge, is they're not currently producing microfilm for the Morning News because of this contractual issue. But in the meantime, what we've done is we have physical copies of the newspaper that we have in our archive that we try to keep just to supplement that. So even though it might not be available in, you know, the database or in microfilm, we should have, with the exception of a gap there when that first started occurring, we should have a physical paper in our limited access area that we can retrieve for you to look at. When we also have scanners that we a public scanner in our reading room that will allow you to do a scanning of the material for free. You can email it to yourself or save it on a thumb drive. So if you need to, you can always take the newspaper, scan it, and then, you know, save it, and you'd have a copy of it digitally. So, yes?
Once again, I'm totally overwhelmed. When are you going to put the, when are you going to put your presentation on the Dallas Genealogy Society so I can go back and look up something?
I'm going to actually send you a copy of a PDF version of this, and you can disseminate it to all your members. Well, and any more questions?
Do you have school records or DISD?
We do have some DISD stuff. I don't know the total scope. I know we have a lot of reports and things that were done. I think we've got some. It kind of depends on the individual manuscript collections. I know, I think Juanita Craft's collection might have some stuff in there too. Anita Martinez's collection, I think, had some stuff that was DISD. But that's something that can be, we can search for you. And actually, you should be able to do a search. When you go to our website and you click on one of the buttons, whether it's, maps or history or whatever, there should be a search box. And if you search that, it should pull up anything related to what we have. And a lot of what will come up was our manuscript collection finding guides. So that can help you narrow that, or if not, you can always contact us and we can look into it. But I know we got some DISD stuff. It kind of depends on what it is. Okay.
Regarding your photography collections, can you search by photographer also?
We can. You can on the photography collection is a little bit tricky because it's kind of done. It exists kind of in different phases. We've got a portion of them, as I mentioned, in the online catalog, so that's easiest to search because you can, if we knew the photographer's name and it got entered, then it would have been entered into the record, and so you could search it that way. But then the largest portion of our collection is not digitized and put in the catalog. It actually exists in the form of a staff-side database. So basically, one of our photo team has to then search it for you and then send you, what you would get is an Excel spreadsheet with a listing of what the photographs would be, and then we'd have to like pull them for you to look at. So that's a little more complicated, but it's totally doable, and we can definitely search that by photographer as well. Okay. And if anybody wants a tour of the public side of this floor, just be gathering in the back, and I myself and a colleague will break you up into groups and give you tours in a few minutes.
Thank you very much.
No problem.
Although you did overlook one of the most important collections that you have, too, and that's our archives, which are our house.
Oh,
right,
that's
here as
true.
Well. Thank you for that.
Well, I mean, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. I encourage you to participate in the tour. It's fascinating.
Yeah.
And we will see you all April 1st, if not sooner. Thanks for coming. This has been a presentation of the Dallas Genealogical Society. If you're already a member, thank you. Your membership dues are supporting this and other society activities. If you're not yet a member, I hope you consider joining. You can become a member for as little as $35 a year, and you can join by going to our website, dallasgenealogy.org, and clicking on the membership tab.